So my name is Nathan Ingram. I'm from Birmingham, Alabama, which I'm sure you couldn't tell that from the accent, right? I try to keep the southern accent down a little bit when I travel outside the southeast. I'll try not to say y'all very much, but can you permit me a y'all or two if it pops out during the talk today?
Yes.
I'm the lead organizer at WordCamp Birmingham. We have the greatest hashtag in the whole WordPress community. It's hashtag WPYall. It's wonderful. So this is my first trip to Boston. I'm really enjoying it. I'm the host at iThemes Training, which we do what I call WordCamp all year long. We do 2 or 3 live webinars a week. Most of them are free to the public. You can learn more about that at iThemes.com. There's all kinds of topics from development all the way through business development to content creation like we've just been talking about. Lots of good stuff. So I've personally been a freelance web developer working with clients since 1995, 22 years. I'm a geezer in the web world. I've been all WordPress since 2010. A few years after that, I started coaching business, doing some business coaching for WordPress freelancers. I really enjoy that. It's a lot of what I do. So I always start a talk like this with this slide that says, you know what, I'm not an expert, I'm a learner. We're going to be talking a lot about processes and dealing with problem clients, and my process is in continual evolution. Slowly but surely, every single problem client that comes along teaches me a new way I need to build my fence in my business to keep those problem clients in check. So my qualification for standing before you this morning is the fact that I've simply been doing this long enough to have made all the mistakes already. And if you can learn a little bit from my mistakes today and maybe improve your business and avoid some of the stupid mistakes that I've made, then I've done my job this morning. So here's an overview. We're going to talk just a minute about the concept of a friendly monster. Then we're going to talk about building fences around those monsters so they don't trample the rest of your life. And then we'll wrap up with a really fun little section on 5 monsters you should know and then how to contain them based on the strategies that we've just identified. So the talk is going to fall into 2 basic portions like you see here. And I'm going to try to take questions after each of those. So if you have a question while I'm speaking, just hold that for a few minutes and I'll pause in the middle, which is a natural break, and then I'll ask, we'll do questions again at the end, and I'll ask for those. One last thing, there'll be a link at the end, so if you want the slides, you don't have to scribble furiously, I'll give you a link at the end of the presentation to download all the slides from today. And there's also, if you want to rewatch, there's a full video of this on WordPress TV, it's right there on the link I'll give you from WordCamp Denver last year. Okay, so here's the basic idea. Now, first of all, let me just ask, how many of you guys work with clients? Okay, how many of you guys like to work with clients? Usually. How many of you guys have met a problem client? 5 problem clients. Yeah, see, it doesn't go down no matter how many you add. So, you know, we all, if you're in the freelance world or if you're in the agency world and you're working with clients, we all have struggled with clients that break out of their boundaries and make our lives very difficult. And I start with this statement because I think it's very true. Most clients start out fairly friendly. But every client has the potential for transformation. Because even friendly monsters, as you'll notice, have teeth. So our goal is to build business systems to protect ourselves from friendly monsters. Because if you can mitigate the monsters, it'll prevent them from wasting your time, from wasting your money, and from wasting your emotional capital. How many of you have invested far too much emotional capital in a client that has just run all over your world? Doesn't it drive you crazy? We're going to talk about how to deal with some of that today. And one of the questions I want to ask at the beginning is, do you have a consistent system to your business? As a freelancer, you really have to do that. As a freelancer, it's critical, no matter if you're building websites or whatever piece of the web world that you occupy, it's critical to have a system in place that is consistent. It's the difference, listen, between owning a business and owning your job. And those are 2 very different things. So what I suggest is there are 4 fences that we need to build around these friendly monsters. These 4 fences are, first of all, clarity. We have to establish clarity. 2, commitments, healthy commitments along the way. 3, communication, which is vital. And the fourth, documentation. All four of these fences need to be in place. Otherwise, the monster just walks out the side that's not protected. You might have clarity in place where you're on the same page. You might have all the documentation you need. You might have firm commitments with the client, but if you're not communicating, the monster slips right out the side. You've got to have all four of these fences in place to build a good, healthy system for your business. Let's talk just for a minute about clarity. Clarity is critical when it comes to keeping problem clients in check. Because in my experience, the most common reason that client relationships suffer is a lack of clarity. A lack of clarity. And what I mean by that is something like this. We who live in a technical world often use technical jargon when we're talking to our clients. And it muddies the water. And the client may be shaking their head yes, when in reality they have no idea what you're talking about. And when that happens, we have a problem. We have a lack of clarity. Don't confuse agreement with clarity. There are two completely different things. There can be agreement between you and the client without there being clarity because there was really no meeting of the minds. That client may sign your contract. They may agree to something verbally across the table over coffee. They may do lots of different things where you think you're on the same page, but in actuality, they're thinking something completely different. Have you ever gotten into the middle of the project and you've realized the client hasn't told you something? Oh, where are my customers supposed to log into this website? That's a problem. Now, when those sorts of things occur, whose fault is it? It's really easy for us to become defensive and say that's completely the client's fault. But really, it's at least 50-50. It's at least 50-50. You and I, if you're working with clients, you and I need to develop the skills to ask the right questions throughout the process of dealing with the client so we understand the client's expectations. And listen, let me tell you, that skill of learning how to ask good questions, to drill down into the project until you reach actual clarity, that one soft skill that you can develop as a freelancer working with clients can set you apart from all the other people who are competing with you. Ask great questions, because a lack of clarity will kill your client relationship. Now, that lack of clarity often comes from assumptions. What is the client assuming that you will do? What are you assuming the client will do? And a lot of this comes down to your process. If you have a good process that you use with every client, every project, every time, it's easier to get clarity with the client because you do things the same way for every project. Now, I want to ask for a show of hands on this one, but do you have a consistent process that you use for every client, every project, every time? Because I promise you, in about 4 years of coaching freelancers across the country and some internationally, I can tell you that that's something where almost every freelancer struggles with. Doing it consistently. We just sort of make it happen as a freelancer. And there's some reason in our minds about, well, we're not really going to build a process because every client's different. There aren't that many differences between clients and projects. Having a consistent process in place and not dealing with every client by the seat of the pants can help avoid a lot of assumptions that come along. So the key to clarity is specificity. Being specific about what you're asking the client to do and being specific about what you're going to do for the client. Parts of achieving that kind of specificity are an excellent intake form. Are you using an intake form? By that, what I mean is a set of questions that you ask at the beginning of every project for every client, every time. I've got a list of 65 and growing questions that I ask in that initial client interview, depending on what type of project it is. There's a subsection for e-commerce and things like that. But there's a 65 list questionnaire that I have that I walk through at the beginning of every single client project. And if I do that every time because I'm being consistent, I know that every client has been asked those questions. And it's not really that hard to do. You can sit down and make that list of questions, just thinking through every aspect of the website and what needs to happen. You can do that no matter what area of work that you do. Have a good intake form, to ask the same questions, be consistent. Get very specific about what it is that you're going to deliver. Having a great scope of work in your proposal, where you are specifying exactly what it is you're going to deliver. Now, one of the most common places that I find where a project gets off track, and if you're a web developer, see if you can identify with this, what's the first place where the client seems to miss out on the fact that they have to do something? For me, it's always, oh, you're not going to write the content for my website? How many of you stall on content? Yes. Oh, content is the monster, isn't it? It is difficult. And a lot of clients assume that you, as the web developer, you're going to supply the content. You have to be very clear about that. Having a good contract that explains the process that you're going to go through, what can happen during the project. Good contract is a good balance between expectations and penalties. We expect you to do this, you can expect us to do that, and if one of us doesn't do one of those things, this is what happens as a result. If you're freelancing without a contract, you are walking a tightrope without a parachute. Bad, bad deal. So once we've gotten clarity, we need to move into the area of commitments. Commitment in a client relationship is critical because all healthy relationships are based on healthy commitments. So let me ask, have you ever thought about client relationships in terms of commitment? For years, for me, the commitment that the client supplied was giving me the check. This is back when I was stupid. For years, I was stupid. And the client gave me the check, and now I just made everything happen. And I would go overboard, and I would work like crazy, far too long for what I was being paid. Because really, in that time, for some reason, I just thought that, you know, once the client paid me, it was my job to just get it done. But there has to be a healthy commitment that goes both ways. So the client needs to have clarity on the commitments that you're going to ask them to make throughout the process of building the project. So from the start, whatever process you put in place to build websites, it's consistent. Every client, every project, every time. From the very beginning, your process needs to include opportunities for the client to commit at key points. Let me give you an example. So here's an illustration like a board game. Anybody play board games in here? I grew up playing board games. My favorite one was Sorry. Remember Sorry? That's the one where you hit the slide, you can knock off everybody that was on the slide, you know? I took a little too much delight in that. I would get up and dance around as a kid if I knocked my parents off the slide. Maybe that says something about me as a person. I'm not sure. So this is my process in the graphical sense. So a client comes in and starts the process of designing a website. And we're going to move into this area of first contact, whether they're a referral, which just about all the business I have today is by referral, or maybe they come in, you know, from a phone call, or they come in through a website, whatever. The very first commitment I'm going to ask the client to make at that first contact is to tell them that the minimum price for a website with us starts at about $4,500 and goes up. The minimum price. That's usually one of the first things out of my mouth when we have that conversation. Because I don't want to waste their time, and I don't want them to waste my time. Because if they're calling me looking for that $1,200 website or that $800 website, I'm not the guy. There are others, you know, that operate in those sectors, and that's fine. But that's not me, so I don't want to waste their time or my time. So if we continue the conversation, they've made that tacit commitment that this project is going to be at least $4,500. Does that make sense? We move them on through the process. They go into the second phase where we'll spend some time and have an initial consultation. And we'll sit down over coffee at their office or a coffee shop or whatever. I work from the home office, so I typically don't have clients in my home. And we'll have this conversation. And in that initial conversation, we'll talk through a whole series of things. I'll work through a checklist of questions that I have. And I leave that conversation with this question. And this has been one of the things that has revolutionized the way I work with clients. We end that initial consultation with a ballpark price. I don't know if you've ever done that before, but that can save you the pain of writing proposals. How many of you enjoy writing proposals for client websites? Anybody? If you take hours to pour over the wording and just to get that proposal just right, and you're nuancing over maybe $50 more, maybe $50 less, and you take hours and hours to put a proposal together, that's very normal. I talk to freelancers all the time that do that. But I leave that initial consultation with a statement something like this. Mr. Client, Mrs. Client, based on what you described to me, the project that we're going to build is going to fall between probably $6,500 and $7,500. If I come back to you with a proposal in that price range, are you ready to start today? Before I even write the proposal, the client is going to commit to that ballpark of pricing. Otherwise, I'm not going to give them more time to put a proposal together. Does that make sense? So it's slowly building this commitment level between me and them. I'll invest some time in them, they'll invest some time in me, and it goes back and forth. Now, if they move forward, then we do the proposal in the contract, and I'll commit to them the time to put those things together. They commit back to me with a check and signed documents. That moves us into the first phase of the website creation. That's that dreaded content stage. Now, for years, I chased down content. Have you ever had clients? It's been 6 months since they signed the contract, and we're still waiting on the content. I cannot get them to take pictures of their staff. I cannot get them to write that stupid About Us page. They just won't do it. It's three paragraphs, and they're 9 months up the road, and they still haven't done it. We all live in the same world, don't we? I think there's really only one client, and they circulate between every freelancer in America. So I made a change a few years ago. A friend of mine in Atlanta, at WordCamp Atlanta, just dropped this little word nugget that I've been using ever since, and it goes like this. No code before content. It's beautiful. No code before content. Before we do anything else, we have to have their content in full. All the written content, all the assets, any video, any images, everything has to be provided. That's the commitment we ask the client to make before we do anything else. Now, and by the way, how quickly could you do a website if you started out with all the assets and content? Makes you a lot more efficient and effective too, doesn't it? Okay, so the client commits back to us by providing the content. We move into the design phase where we render out either a web mockup or some visual mockups, depending on what kind of project it is. We ask them to commit again to signing off on that design. So the visuals are established at this point. We don't go back. If we have to go backwards on this track, it starts to cost more. So they sign off on the visuals. Then we go into the actual development of the project. We build those visuals out into an actual website. We start to install their content. And then we move into review and testing. The client, again, reviews everything. They sign off on the process and everything we've developed. Right. Once they sign off on it, then we launch the website. And before launch, they're going to supply the final remaining balance of whatever is due. Then, of course, you move into maintenance, and it's hopefully you have a maintenance contract, some sort of monthly maintenance. If you don't have some sort of recurring revenue structure as a freelancer, where you're providing monthly WordPress hosting, security, backups, updates, you're leaving money on the table. It's virtually impossible to survive as a freelancer if you're trying to survive from client to client just building websites. You've got to have that recurring revenue in place. That's a different talk. So this is my process. And at each point along the way, the client makes a commitment to us, then we make a commitment back to them with more time. Does that make sense? So clearly defining expectations and consequences is critical to this whole concept of commitment. And strategic points in the development process. And this needs to be in your contract and then verbally told to the client along the way. Because, listen, you can tell some clients the same thing 100 times and they don't stay told. Have you met that person? Clients don't stay told a lot of times. So you have to continually throughout the project, I'm emphasizing by email, over the phone, in person, it's in the contract, what we're expecting them to do. So it's clearly defined. And that leads us right into our next fence, which is the area of communication. George Bernard Shaw said, the single biggest problem with communication is the illusion that it has occurred. I love that quote. It's absolutely true, especially for technical things. Communication is critical. Again, if you can develop the soft skill of asking good questions and being a good communicator with your clients, it will set you beyond all the other web developers that you're competing with. So here's what I've learned over the years. Without regular communication, clients make assumptions and they usually assume the worst. So if you're not talking to the client, this thing starts happening in their minds about maybe you've disappeared, because web developers disappear. Have you heard the stories of the disappearing web developers? I can't tell you how much rescue work I've done because some web developer disappeared, evaporated. Who knows where they are? Now I don't have my domain name. I can't get access to my website, and I don't know. It happens all the time. And if avoiding that stigma, communication is critical in that process. So how about this? Be honest. Let's say you're working on a web project and you hit a technical snag. I'm sure that doesn't happen to any of you out there, but let's just assume you have a friend who's a web developer and they hit a technical snag, right? Is your first inclination that to tell the client and communicate with them about this issue you're experiencing? See, somebody's shaking their head yes. How many of you, it's your first inclination to go run in the cave and hide and hope the client doesn't call and ask how their website is going? That's probably more along the lines of where most of us are. Now, here's the problem with that. It stresses you out, doesn't it? And it makes the challenge of solving that problem even greater. It's important to be transparent enough with our clients so that we're communicating well. Because few things can improve the client's experience more than clear, regular communication. Again, if you want to set yourself apart from other developers, being great at communicating is critical. Most of us who are in the technical world struggle with this. It's hard. Because we're good at the details, which means typically we're not so good with people. Usually a detailed person is not very good with people. Very rarely do those two skill sets collide. So it's okay. It's okay if you struggle with dealing with people and having difficult conversations. That's okay. It's a skill you can learn. And let me give you a very simple way that I've learned to do that over the years. It's what I call the three-sentence email. This is not original to me. I picked it up somewhere along the way, and I've been using it for years. Every Friday, all of our clients who have active projects get the three-sentence email. Sometimes it's four, it just depends. But it's a three-sentence email, typically. It focuses on the past, the present, and the future. Dear Mr. Client, this is Client. This is what we did on your project this week. That's the past. This is where things are now in terms of the project. Present. This is what we'll be doing next week. Future. If you have any questions or concerns, please reach out to us and let us know. Our clients, over and over again, say they love that basic communication. You know what? It takes me 5 minutes or less to do. And it's in that email where you can explain, dear Mr. Client, Mrs. Client, today, this week we were working on your store and we had this issue with WooCommerce talking to that stupid USPS integration thing to get live shipping. It drives me crazy. This has put us back 2 or 3 days on your project. We anticipate getting this solved next week. We hope we'll be able to make up that time later and still launch your site on time. That's how you communicate an issue. Don't hide from it. Be clear about it. Don't overshare. But just be clear about the fact, you know what, we've hit a delay. A client will appreciate you communicating about an issue rather than hiding it and all of a sudden the site is weeks overdue as a result. Just communicate. In a three-sentence email, past, present, and future. You can do that. Last of all, Documentation. We live in an electronic age. And oftentimes, as we're dealing with our clients, we do so verbally. We have to get used to documenting things in writing because written communication is referenceable. Anytime you make a decision with a client verbally, whether it's over the phone or in a face-to-face meeting, always email the client after that interaction to confirm what was decided. We're going to look at one of the difficult client types in a minute who never remembers anything that you tell them. Ever. They never remember decisions made verbally. So written communication is referenceable. Well, you know, last Tuesday we met about that, and here's the email where you said, let's go. Written communication is referenceable. Because if you don't document, you're relying on your own memory, or worse, the client's. You remember all these things. Document, document, document. So my encouragement to you is to implement a system that can easily capture all project communication. There's a lot of them out there. Pick one. I mean, there's Basecamp, there's Teamwork, there's Evernote, Asana, some CRM that you like. Don't just use email, because I guarantee you the time that you're looking for that one email, it's not going to be there, and you're not going to be able to find it. It's happened to me over and over. I personally use Evernote. I've used it for years. Everything's in there. I've got a little system. It works great. Depending on how many projects you're doing and your type of clients, you know, a more formal system like Basecamp or Teamwork might work. It just depends on what you're doing. The point is not that one of these is better than the other, except for just email. Don't do that. The point is not that one of these is better than the other. The point is pick the best one for you and then use it. Use it consistently. Because here's the nature of us nerds. Okay, and tell me if I'm wrong. The nature of us nerds is to identify this problem like, I've got to find this great client management system. And we'll spend 3 months looking at project management systems. Or we'll, even worse, build one ourselves and take forever and ever to build the perfect thing, and then we never use it. Isn't that true? So my point here is, pick one that works for you and just use it. Just use it consistently. A system that you use consistently is better than the perfect system. So, clients are friendly monsters. We got to build fences around these friendly monsters so they do not trample over the rest of our world. It takes clarity. It takes commitments. It takes communication. It takes documentation. Let me make one more point before I ask for some questions here. Don't tear down your own fences. Let me explain what I mean by that. This is critical, especially if you are a nice person. How many of you are nice to your client to the extent that you let them get away with murder, you don't charge them nearly enough to cover the time that you've put in? If you're that kind of person, you're awesome. Okay, you're awesome. We all want to meet you and have lunch with you. But if you're that kind of person and you know that's your tendency, you've got to have great fences to protect yourself. Because here's what will happen. Inevitably, if you're dealing with a client and they want to weasel out of one of the systems you've created and put into place in your process, you might find yourself tempted to let them do that. Oh, they're so nice. Oh, they've just been a client for so many years. Oh, it's not really that big of a deal. You start to make excuses for the client, and you justify yourself out of holding the client accountable to the agreement that they've committed to. And for about 10 minutes, that feels really good. Oh, I'm such great customer service. And you pat yourself on the back. But then, what happens? You start getting angry about it in a passive-aggressive way. It starts in the back of your skull. It starts to grow and grow. And by the end of the day, you're ready to walk. You're ready to go back home with me. Walk upstairs, and my wife and my kids are there, and I'm just not in a great mood because I can't believe this client. They agreed to all this, and so you're mad at. I'm mad at my wife. I'm mad at the kids. I'm mad at the dog. The insanity of all this is that instead of forcing a stranger to live with the consequences they've earned, we take it out of the people closest to us. Isn't that crazy? Okay, I just got the 10-minute sign. This is usually not what we call it. I should have sped it up. So I'm going to skip the questions, and I'm going to jump right into five monsters you should know and how to contain them. We're going to probably do just a couple of these. I'll go as quickly as I can. The first one is the question mark. How many of you have met the question mark? This is the client that asks a million questions. He has no idea what he wants or he wants everything. He asks endless questions. He has no goals and no budget. Anybody have the question mark? Yeah. So the question mark, if you're dealing with one of these folks, you have to focus on commitment. These clients are classic time wasters. And if you go into dealing with a question mark, trying to be a nice person, you'll invest hours of your time before they ever even consider making a commitment to you. When I go into an initial client consultation with a question mark, use that intake form. You control the conversation. Don't let them control the conversation. And get to price early. The way to shut up a question mark is with a dollar sign. Because as soon as you put money on the table, it got real. And it's out of your little dream world of asking a million questions. Can't allow the question mark to monopolize your time. All right, the next client is the invisible man. And the invisible man is awesome. The invisible man is the one who expresses interest and then disappears. You have those folks? Oh, they've got to build a website. It's got to be done by next week. And then they're gone. They're crickets. You can't find them. Where are they? Or they repeatedly reschedule planned meetings. Or they take forever to respond to an email. They're hot and then they're cold. Usually these folks are well-intentioned, but they're busy. The website is not a top priority to them. They're usually a business owner, and they've got other irons in the fire. And maybe it was important today, but now, you know, the roof is leaking. We have to deal with that. What we have to realize about the question mark is that they're going to disappear repeatedly during the project also, just like they disappeared when you're first starting to communicate with them. Then they'll reappear when it's a priority again, and they're wondering why the website isn't done, but they haven't done anything you've asked them to do. This is the invisible man. I used to get so angry at these clients. Why are they doing this to me? And the answer is because I let them. I let them do it. So you have to focus on clarity with the invisible man. Create a process to deal with disappearing clients and make sure the client understands that process. So in our process, in our contract, we have very clear wording that says, if we're waiting for you for longer than 30 days, the project goes into a suspended mode. And before we ever pick up the project again, the balance is due in full. So if you want to delay, that's fine, but we're going to get paid in full for the project. And there's other time attachments to that as well, where ultimately they'll forfeit all the work we've done on the project, and that's it. I've waited for 2 years for a client to finish a project. That's ridiculous. Again, make sure you remind the client through the process, because lots of clients don't stay told. Okay. Boundary buster. Oh, this guy's awesome. The boundary buster is the one who sends a 3 a.m. email with a 7:30 follow-up. Have you met this guy? This is the one that insists on meetings after hours. He works on weekends and holidays. He expects you to as well. And when you don't, he's going to fuss at you about it. So when you deal with a boundary buster, you have to focus on commitment. You got to clearly communicate when you work. I'm sorry, Mr. Client, Mrs. Client. I work during normal business hours, not on the weekends or the holidays. My family is too important to me. My kids are too important. I don't get these years back with my kids. You need me outside of work hours for a true emergency? It's just going to cost more. I'm sorry. How about this? Have you ever been sitting in a chair watching TV or sitting in bed watching Netflix at night? It's 10 p.m. and you get that email from a client. It's just a small request. Just a small request. And so you think to yourself, I'm going to provide great customer service. So you open up your laptop, you make the quick revision on their website, you hit publish, you email them back, we're done. 10:02, 2 minutes record time, aren't I awesome? What have you just done? You've trained your client that you work at 10 o'clock at night. You've just fed the mogwai after midnight. And what does it do? It turns into a monster. I just dated myself with that comment. Does anybody know what I'm talking about today? Okay, a few of you, okay. It is what it is. You create a monster. You train your client to expect that from you. So you have to set the tone in the initial meetings. Don't violate your boundaries. This kind of client is excellent candidate for what I call the PETA surcharge, which stands for pain in the asterisk, right? Sometimes, by the way, it's appropriate to just fire the client. We were having that conversation here earlier today. All right, next one is a penny pincher. The penny pincher. This is the one that wants an $8,000 website for $1,000. They're overly concerned with cost. They don't respect you or your work, or here's the big one, they want to pay you in equity. You ever had the equity deal? Oh, they got this greatest business idea ever. If you'll just build the website, I'll bring you in as 20%. So my response to that, and by the way, I've done this because I was stupid for many years, never ever in all the years I've been doing this has an equity deal ever worked out. Ever. Because what that person is essentially asking me to do is to believe in their idea that they don't believe in enough to put their own money behind it. So you want me to put my money into something you don't believe in? It's crazy. The penny pincher wants something for nothing or too much for not enough. So clarity, again, is important with this type of person. Be sure your work, your scope of work is crystal clear, because these folks are going to try to get every blood out of a turnip type people. They're going to try to get every extra bit of work out of you they can. So be crystal clear. You don't have to work with everybody. One more and we're done, and I'll take questions here. A drama queen. How many of you have worked with a drama queen? This is not gender specific, by the way. There are plenty of drama kings out there. This is what one of my coaching clients calls her diva clients. Diva clients are very difficult because everything is an emergency. The drama queen's favorite word is now. It's got to be done right now. Or they work with a previous developer who did everything wrong. The minute those words come out of a client's mouth, the initial client consultation, I'm digging into that statement. Because a lot of times what you'll find out is this developer did everything they were supposed to do, and this client is a pain to work with. And guess what? If you work with that client, 9 months from now, she's going to be sitting across the table from another potential web developer talking about how you did everything wrong. Right? She'll be complaining about you to some other poor schmuck. So focus on documentation. When you deal with a drama queen, system trumps drama. System trumps drama. This is the one that you've got to have the full fence around. And again, this is the one where you want to be very careful about the records you keep, because drama queens change their mind at a moment's notice. The wind changes direction, she's going to change her direction, or he's going to change his direction. Documentation is absolutely critical. So, clients, friendly monsters. We need these four fences: clarity, commitment, communication, documentation. I'll end it with this question. Today, how strong are your fences? How strong are the fences in your business? And dream a little bit. How would your business be better if you put in a clear process that you followed every client, every project, every time, and kept those problem clients in check? How much better would your business be? How much more profitable would your business be? How much better would your life be if you kept those problem clients from trampling the rest of your garden? All right. We'll pause for questions. There's a link at the bottom there, nathaningram.com/WCBOS. You can get all the slides from today's presentation there. There's a video of this from WordCamp Denver that's there, and some information about the Recurring Revenue Summit coming up on iTunes. Questions? How I organize my Evernote system? That's a longer question than I can answer in here, but if you'll grab me at lunch, we'll sit down and talk. By the way, anybody who wants to sit down and talk over lunch, that's where we're going, right? So grab, let's talk. Yes, sir.
I work as a middleman between a project manager and a designer and a client. How can I be more clear about how their designs are going to impact their teams?
That's a great question. So the question is, in the sense where you're essentially working as a contractor between the end client and the other person who's hiring you, how do you do that and have a good system? It's such a great question. You can approach that two ways. Number one, your client is not the client. Your client is the middleman. So you need to have good processes and good clarity and communication between that person first and then the client. And if you can... chances are that person who is actually dealing directly with the client has those same issues with clients like we all do. And so you work together to improve their process, which in turn makes your life better. Yes?
You said that we should get all the content before doing the design of the site. So how do you agree on what content is needed?
Okay, that's a great question. Okay, we're done. I'll answer this question, we'll be out of here. The question was, how do you know what the content is you want the client to provide? So the very first thing I do when the client gives me the signed documentation and deposit is I provide a content map. So we're going to look at every single page of the site that we're going to design. It takes several hours of work at the beginning. And from that, we're going to, I build a document where I ask proactive questions to the client based on all of those pieces of content we need to create and give them essentially a very large checklist that helps them to provide the content they need. If that's overwhelming to them, anytime you find a problem in your process, it's an opportunity to offer another service to solve that problem. So what we started doing a few years ago was providing a content writer to come in for an extra fee, usually $1,200 or so, to actually write the content of the site for the client.